Everyone, it's Alex, and I'm starting off this year and this month with a wrap-up, which feels rare. Overall, much like my personal life this month, this reading month has been a bit up and down for me, but there's some really great highs and some really great lows too. And this month I read a couple of review copies, so those both come out next week, so I'll be sure to mention what books those are throughout the wrap-up. And starting off, I do want to mention Memorial by Brian Washington that I actually did a separate video on earlier this month. Memorial is about two men, Mike and Ben, who are in a relationship, but they're kind of wondering as of late where it kind of falls into place in regard to two big life events that are happening. One is that Mike is going back to Japan to take care of his father, who is in poor health. And because of Mike doing that, Ben is actually staying in town and taking care of Mike's mother, who happens to be visiting at the same time that Mike decides to go out of town and take care of his father. I know it sounds sitcom-y, but I feel like Memorial really surprised me in its own way of being a novel that I didn't expect to denounce romanticism as a concept of having to feel like you have to be with someone, especially in an LGBTQ story. Largely because, other than also this being a book about two gay men of color, I also thought it was nice of it being a refreshing spin on the coming out narrative for both Mike and Ben at the same time. Washington's observations are really sharp in terms of conceptualizing some observations about one's sexuality being narrativized both internally and externally, while also not sparing Mike and Ben from having an evolving consciousness about realizing how, as they're growing as their own people, they are becoming different people. That being said, I think Washington does struggle with stumbling around having his characters sort of penetrating exactly what they're actively thinking. So even as Mike and Ben are sort of growing apart, I didn't really get that distinction because the use of flashbacks as a narrative device. Manifesting this passiveness, I assume what was supposed to come off as being this effortlessness and feeling cool rather felt much more like a facade. But yeah, if you are looking, I would say, for a refreshing LGBTQ book or story, I would pick up Memorial. But in terms of like literary fiction, which is the camp that it kind of falls within, I would say you could probably look elsewhere. So the next read is actually another LGBTQ book, but is actually one I would not recommend, and that is The Prettiest Star by Carter Sickles. I read this as a part of my reading plans for reading Appalachian-based literature for the year. This book is about a man named Brian who, at the turn of the AIDS crisis, as it's becoming more stigmatized in the narrative of the country in the 80s, he moves from NYC back to his hometown in Ohio. So at times with how this book is written, there are these jagged turns of phrase that Sickles likes to use as his writing style that read to me as the same rhythm of poetry, which I thought was a nice sort of grasp at the emotional thrust of the storytelling, but without it feeling too melodramatic. With these phrases, or the writing sort of being more about that emotional thrust, Sickles also prefers having his characters in isolation with these changes in perspective between four characters where they can kind of create their own vignettes about what their life and their observations within Ohio are kind of like. And with those four people, one of them is Brian and his sister, his mother, and I think it was his grandmother. Although it quickly occurred to me that Sickles is someone that finds characterization a chore. Characters are unfortunately really flat because they are so preoccupied with trying to wonder so conveniently about how their thoughts conflict between the four of them about the growing AIDS narrative in the 80s. And this is where Sickles tries to create conflict, not so much within the actual story itself, but between the combating themes that each of the characters are feeling, which feel unfortunately very one note and are always dusted off with a really lazy metaphor. The writing, even beyond the characters, feels really barren because the backdrop of Appalachia barely feels like it's there, that I really couldn't separate other than feeling like it's just a small town that happens to be even more extremely homophobic. I think Sickles does try to redeem himself by giving Brian specifically his own perspective of feeling a bit more unique with the narrative that Brian has this idea of self-recording himself at the request of his old lover who recently died. But even with how Sickles creates this unique perspective for Brian with a sense of storytelling, it feels more inconvenient than innovative. Over time, with Brian's shtick with this recording self bit, he even fades into the background of the story for me, which is crazy because he's supposed to be like the main character of this book, I would say. I couldn't really pinpoint Brian's motivations entirely of why he moved back to Ohio, or really how the narrative push for this self-recording I thought would be more about the inner layers of trying to figure out what dispels or what embraces or empowers one's sexuality, which wasn't there at all. Because unfortunately, this book does feel very info dumpy about maybe it making me wonder like why this book was even published in 2020. And I think it is for maybe the general audience of literally who's maybe never read a gay fiction book before. So unfortunately it did read off as very commercial in its own way, but mainly if I have to read one more aquatic animal metaphor from the sister, I was going to scream. So up next, thinking of similarly gay books, this one's actually a work of nonfiction and it comes out next week, and it is Gay Bar by Jeremy Atherton Lynn. Like I said, this is a work of nonfiction that really has Lynn compiling these journalistic citations of the observations of gay bars throughout history, and particularly their influence in the gay community, and also with these really nice interwoven micro-memoirs on Lynn's behalf about his own experience throughout this time. So with this folding of Lynn talking about the cultural identity developing within gay bars, it was really great to see these transitions of Lynn's real life and also what he's researching based on the surrounding concept of intimacy, which perhaps could be a great encompassing term for gay bars. But the tone of this shift of the historical and personal remains the same, as Lynn never gets too far from trying to mythologize his own life of his gay identity being anything separate from the general gay experience. And he acknowledges that his own selection of gay identifiers being equated to his personhood, being that with the evidence of what he's actually researching and how he's talking about these bars in history, kind of also developed this public consciousness about the narrative of gay or queer people. For Lynn, some of these citations would be a developing argument about how maybe gay bars are fading in the background as we become more progressive as a society, so we wonder if there's really a need for them and a sense of community, while also questioning how spaces as a literal place serve people in terms of certain populations that are maybe even beyond the gay community, and of course also the capitalist notion of being gay as being something marketable and something that can be taken advantage of. Or some other self-identifying personhood inquiries that Lynn taps into, some of my favorites being wondering if I have to like Starships by Nicki Minaj, and also wondering if this boy I'm about to talk to is gonna tell me about Ann Carson again. But definitely the string along this work is how Lynn talks about recurringly this man named Famous, who he has been with for a good amount of years. While the book certainly doesn't get into like that romantic territory of that being what this book is about, I think that consistency does sort of cycle back to the overall theme of being how we define intimacy. Even as these gay bars are being described as what I will put generously, vividly, there is something ephemeral about how these bars are being described as, again, these time capsules in history, but at the same time, I really appreciated Lynn's delicacy of really trying to explain the significance of the identity of not really understanding or wanting to be a part of a sense of community, but realizing that it's there. And to top it all off, Lynn's storytelling enough for me makes this an endearing read even beyond the historical context. For this next book, I also read it after The Prettiest Star, so it was a nice palate cleanser, and it's Invisible Cities by Italo Calvino, which really instilled in me, again reminding me of the joy of reading. This is a book about the real traveler Marco Polo as he's explaining all these cities he's been to an emperor. I'm familiar with Calvino having read If on a Winter's Night a Traveler a few years ago, so I was definitely expecting some postmodern portal across the pages. But I actually picked this book up because it was told to me that it was someone's favorite, which is always a comment about a book that I hold in high esteem. And I think the best word to describe this book is delightful, because I think it's really this medicine of reminding me again sort of the joy of reading. Reminding me in general that it's not necessarily the intentional content of the book I'm reading that I enjoy, but really just that progress or the feeling of reading a book that feels good to think about. Hearing Marco Polo talk about all these cities he's been to as being these stacked experiences of not only being accountable for all the memories that you have about what matters to you as an experience worth remembering, but also being perceptive and aware, which maybe is something a lot of people don't even get to do in their whole life, is how one experience is given so much power based on other people around you, and how the inhabitants of any city, or I guess really any experience that you share with someone, really is something worth cherishing, even if it's something you don't have to remember. So yeah, a little quaint feel-good book that I really enjoyed, and I think also is a nice sort of little happy coincidence to read at the beginning of a year. Up next is a book I feel like needs no introduction and is really one of the better fiction books I've read, objectively I would say, and that is Hamnet by Maggie O'Farrell. This book is a historical account of a boy named Hamnet and his family in the late 1500s during the Black Plague. And by extension, it's really an exercise at how Maggie O'Farrell mythologized this real person back in history, but also with some little clues and Easter eggs towards how Shakespeare himself was also inspired by Hamnet to write Hamlet. The novel itself is really great at easing you into a sense of storytelling, as it opens with Hamnet trying to figure out what to do for his sister that is in poor health. By doing this, O'Farrell expertly sets the stage, if you will, by introducing some base characteristics of fellow characters that become more important in this story as we sort of anticipate what their reaction to this growing crisis would be. And O'Farrell simultaneously creates this world building that really creeps up on you, that at times somehow feels both outdated in a good way, but also modern towards talking about things that are timeless, like family, love, and grief. That being said, I don't want anyone to feel turned off that this is historical fiction, because it doesn't really try to bound itself to time and place literally. It's definitely much more a character-driven story about the thematic undertones that remain timeless throughout history, particularly through the character of Agnes, who I would call the main character of this story despite the title. And Agnes, being Hamnet's mother, I think is the true scene stealer of this book, telling the sort of painful agony of motherhood and sacrifice, and the imitation and repetition of life in general and all of its woes. So yeah, I think this book really is a great package for everything, whether it's some nice pause for prose or the cleverness of creating intrigue and tension with what the story is inspired by. And the key word being what I think is particular about that word I used, imitation, and how I think this is just a really well-executed novel that I read in recent memory. And finally, the last book I want to talk about is one I'm even hesitant to call a novel. It also comes out next week, and it is Fake Accounts by Lauren Euler. The story follows an unnamed narrator as we find out that her boyfriend is a popular anonymous online conspiracy theorist. And the reason I gave that note earlier about this barely feeling like a novel is because, truthfully, it barely feels like there are characters in this book, and the narrative itself is really flimsy. While we do follow a series of events in the book, it feels less like a progression of sequences, but is instead more like frozen moments that appear as someone's life event on their timeline on Facebook. But the way in which the unnamed narrator sort of goes about her conscious thoughts is that we are made aware that we are a deliberate audience. Although that doesn't play into any factor of the book trying to feel like it's trying to contest what is true versus the imaginary, thinking of books like The Pisces by Melissa Broder and Death in Our Hands by Tessa Moshfegh, two books that I think are actively engaged in understanding the parameters of their fictional world, where I feel like Fake Accounts is against that. Fake Accounts is instead relentlessly rooted in realism, really talking about even life events like the Women's March right after Trump's inauguration. By contrast, the goal is also not to turn reality into fiction like some sort of cautionary tale. Rather, our narrator, who is a blogger by day, practically just wants to indulge in her thoughts pertaining to one example being practically wanting to do a research paper on dating apps. She begins to wonder what the exact limitations are, really what determines crossing the line of being a presence in the world, a presence so strong as being a popular online conspiracy theorist. Hence, maybe at the revelation of finding out her boyfriend is an online conspiracy theorist, we do find out that what we're reading is an active novel that the narrator is writing. So what I think Fake Accounts is really good at is trying to pinpoint the difference between authenticity and artificiality. Not even with technology, but really more so the hope in the future of who you think you could become being more capable with the resources of media that become so limitless. Having our narrator always stress that no matter what, you're always at the mercy of being perceived, which she comments on. While she does value our input, she also does still retain this confident composure. But her confidence isn't from like having a big ego. I think instead it's really her trying to realize how well she's been doing at describing her life consistently. At one point, she says to us, "My rent being so low that I'm not going to tell you what it was, teetering as I am already on the border between likable and loathsome." This is why reading isolated parts of the book, like the Woman's March or about dating apps, feels much more like an invasion of privacy. As we are made aware earlier that we are an audience to this narrator, she can't help whether or not we permit ourselves to feeling like a confidant or a passive spectator, thus reinforcing the rhetorical notions of what it really means to get to know somebody, and maybe what we rely on to understand that, maybe with some anticipated social cues, maybe through our body language or other mannerisms that we can't quite capture online. Some parts of this where I thought it was great where this is being demonstrated is a part in real life where the narrator is describing one of the first times meeting her boyfriend. That I could see through things like this made me think I might understand him, that I might have the upper hand. And since he performed so well over the course of the night, withholding at some moments to suggest he might not be as interested as I suspected he was, showing off to demonstrate at times he possessed all the good qualities, smarts, worldliness, humor, etc. I caught myself tallying the score, wondering which one of us was going to come away the more eager, and therefore the less attractive, forgetting, I suppose, we lived in different countries, and that truly smart, funny, worldly people have one-night stands in foreign cities without imagining who would win in their hypothetical relationship. Overall, I think that Euler is trying to comment that whether offline or online, at this point in time, we've really just begun to normalize the internet. That we have to go from wondering when we consciously begin to narrativize ourselves or whenever we become unconsciously performative. We are a generation that has become sort of experts on this unintentional soft skill of being perceptive to one's accuracy of their personality and thus their authenticity. As Euler even literally puts in these parts in the dialogue of these severed ha-has that come off as both relieving in a scene but also reinforces that artificiality I mentioned earlier, making us maybe wonder if we really even have the standard capacity of communication to want to see people for who they really are. Normally with things like social media or the internet, I think it's popular to ask oneself things like, who am I? But in fake accounts, it just really surprised me with our curious and demurred narrator really going all the way to feeling like, of sorts, an internet anthropologist trying to pinpoint exactly what that question means. Or truthfully, maybe she's just being super nosy, as another favorite quote of mine is when she asks herself, who am I, Joan Didion? So my final verdict on fake accounts is that I really loved it. Euler creates prose that is really bare, but it really feels in a sense that I'm doom scrolling someone's life. And I think her real life experience at her profession being a critic, I think it really shows in the narrator's voice of being both opinionated but also tactful. That being said again, I do think Fake Accounts is barely a novel, but maybe that in itself is being representative of the capital V void for the internet itself, so maybe it's appropriate. And we finally made it to the end, so that is my January wrap-up, so I feel like I'm off to a great start. Even though with this year I do only have that cap of wanting to only read 52 books, I'm excited to see what the rest of the year has in store. If you've read any of these books, or if you're interested in reading Gay Bar and Fake Accounts whenever it comes out soon, definitely let me know, because I would eventually love to hear your thoughts too. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.